And Dr. Radha, let me ask you this. So we know that immune, we advance in age, and also as we advance in age, we pick up various health conditions. Could be like what we deal with on a daily basis, obesity, diabetes, hypertension, cholesterol levels, multiple other health conditions. So how do you feel the immunity correlates with the change in age and the comorbid factors that are happening in your, the way you see it?
Thank you so much, Doctor. Immunity is affected, and it's a known fact to many of us that as we age, our immunity does reduce. But there is a certain amount of population where, if they have stayed healthy for a long period of time, their immune system is much stronger than those whose nutritional status was not good. So that's one thing. Another thing is, as we age, the immune components in our body, like the T cells, like the B cells, begin to reduce in numbers. So there is a little immune compromise that happens, but that can be corrected with diet as we age and with physical activity. Added to this, if we have certain amount of metabolic disorders like obesity, like diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, or cardiovascular disease, these are all inflammatory conditions which reduce or pose a challenge to our immune system. Being obese and in the elderly, when your immunity is slightly lower than somebody who's normal weight and the same age. So these are things that we have to really take care over the years to correct our gut, which is the largest immune organ, and stay healthy, and also not have any of these metabolic disorders or keep them at control so that your immunity is much stronger. With the recent infection that has happened globally, if you see the case fatality rate or the mortality and morbidity that happens with age increases. If you see young children, it's negligible. If you see in adults, young adults, it's about 1%, the global data that shows. And if you go to 60 years, it has increased to 4%. If you go to 70 years, it's gone to 9%. And if you go 80 years and above, it's gone to 18% of case fatality rate. So this is how age affects our immune response to infection. And diet is one most doable factor that helps in maintaining our immune.
Right. Now, very, very well said. Essentially, as we age, I think our muscle mass comes down. We tend to gain weight in the less desired areas. The apple shape, the truncal obesity leads on to us picking up various conditions, metabolic syndrome, type 2 diabetes. So naturally, it makes us sort of go low on the immunity and then probably more prone for conditions. So I think as Asians and Indians in Asia Pacific zone, we're also seeing that there's a higher incidence of obesity and diabetes, combination thereof, which is a diabesity. The age-old remedies that have been spoken to from our grandmothers and grandparents, whichever. And yes, keeping, staying well hydrated and eating balanced meal, I think that is the key. Not overdoing anything, really, but staying in balance. So even the supplements we will talk about a little bit more, I think somebody is healthy. You don't need to overboard on the supplements and vitamins and minerals more than what you really need. For a person who is deficient in all these things, I think these supplements would help. Otherwise, I don't think they would be of such a great help. Now, one of the macro elements that we always look into, let's go to Dr. Radha here for a moment, is that we look into protein. See, as a nutritionist, as a bariatric surgeon, almost on a daily basis, we talk about protein, 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 right? So there are various sources of protein. There's a certain amount of daily requirement for a healthy individual versus amount of protein that is required for a person who's recovering from a bariatric surgery or somebody's recovering from a long-term illness. A lot of variations are possible. So in your opinion, so can you elaborate on the various sources of protein that are available today? Daily requirement of protein for a regular person, post-op, as well as a person who is struggling with an illness, and also how does a individual, a regular individual, get enough protein through their diet instead of taking any supplements? Please take it off.
Thank you, sir. Protein is one thing. If you really look into a healthy individual or a normal healthy adult, according to the NIN ICMR recommendations, they say 1 gram per kg body weight protein is the recommended dietary allowance. They initially said it is 0.3, but because majority of our population being vegetarian and for the absorption of the amino acids that are there in the vegetarian sources of protein, they said 1 gram would be correct per kg body weight than taking a higher, lower amount. So this is in sync with the FAO and the WHO guidelines also talking about the RDLs. But this goes slightly higher when the individual is hospitalized. It may go somewhere between 1.2 to 1.5 depending on the degree of requirement and the existing nutritional status. And sometimes if there's a major surgery, it may go up even from 1.5 to 2 grams per kg body weight depending on what is the extent of recovery, what is the risk of malnutrition that the patient would have, and how long would the hospitalization would take for the patient condition. So these are things dictated, it's all individualized. They are done as per the guidelines that are put forth by international and the Indian practice guidelines, where Rona ma'am is one of the authors of the Indian practice guidelines, which has given us recommendations about the protein requirements. This is one, and there are different kinds of protein that can be taken from non-vegetarian sources and vegetarian sources of protein. Non-vegetarian are known to be of high biological value. That means the percentage of bioavailability of this protein to the body is greater when compared to vegetarian sources of protein like pulses. So what they do is, if you can, even milk is a high biological value protein. So it's not necessary that vegetarians don't get enough protein as not the way of working out. They do get, but it is necessary to know that the combination of protein is important. Make a combination of pulses, make a combination of milk and milk products, cereals and pulses, so that you get good quality protein and the bioavailability is good. Non-vegetarian sources are better. But if the individual is healthy, then a regular diet is advisable with good physical activity. But say a person is hospitalized, depending on the requirement of the protein for that individual, we decide on whether the patient requires an extra supplement or not. This is again individualized, not for everybody. Again, depending on what is their intake. For how long have they been on a poor intake, and what is the risk of malnutrition? What is the existing nutritional standard status of that person? And then what is the medical condition? All these dictate on whether a supplement can be advised for this patient or not. And again, within these supplements also, we make a choice on what is the quality of protein that is available in these products, whether you take a whey-based protein or an intact protein and take a semi-supplementary protein, different kinds of protein that you take and advise accordingly. There are different pulses, again, make a combination along with an oral diet. Some of them say that you can, they are over vegetarian, so you just give them a vegetarian diet with egg, where egg is a good source of protein, bioavailability is also good. Along with that, with the requirement of vitamin D, for example, it's a pretty, egg yolk is a good source of vitamin D, so you make a combination of all these and make it available to the give a dietary advice to the patient.
Right. I think you well said protein requirement is there for most, especially protein energy malnutrition is one of the major issues that we struggle with in our nation. as it is in most of the general population. One thing you said is that 1 gram per kilogram of body weight, the protein requirement for 1 gram per kilogram. So it's 1 gram per kilogram of ideal body weight, correct? Is that what you meant? So
body forgot on that answer.
If the person is
overweight, then the recommendations change or the weight calculations change. So it is ideal body.
Yeah, so what Dr. Radha is mentioning is that if somebody is 5 feet 10 inches, their ideal body weight is 72 kilos, then they should be taking around 65, 70 grams of protein. But if their current weight is 130 kilos, you should not jump into taking 130 grams of protein. So it is more mainly for 1 gram per kilogram of ideal body weight. And you also raised vitamin B now being associated with various conditions and obesity, and it is so important that in post-operative, after a year, 2 years, 3 years, if somebody is regaining weight in our patients who had had bariatric surgery, one of the first things we're doing these days is checking the vitamin D level. It is correlating very well with the weight regain, and then when you supplement them, they're tending to lose weight. And also vitamin D, while it is related to attributed to respiratory conditions, it is also correlating with depression. Where there's a low vitamin D, there's a higher incidence of depression. You know, depression is a vicious cycle. It leads to unnecessary binge eating and then leads to weight gain, and one leads to the other. So, and another important point you talked about, eating whole egg. Absolutely agree with you. Only thing for the audience, one important factor is that when you look at the yolk, if it is nice and yellow, it probably is not the best of the yolks. But if it is nice and orange, it is the best yolk to have because it is loaded with vitamin D. So you want to, if you have an option to get a country egg, that probably is a better option than a farm egg. I think so. And people are bored. They want to get out, get back to their normal lives. They probably ran out of shows on TV now by this time. So in this situation, people are gaining weight. So what would you, like a few bullet points, take home points for all the audience here, what would you recommend in terms of how do you limit the amount of calorie intake while maintaining a balanced diet, and the lifestyle, what would you suggest? And also, as you know, once you gain weight, you know, as we just talked about, the immunity levels tend to come down. So we don't want to lose on the immunity. At the same time, we don't want to go on a crash diet because crash diet again makes you less immune. So how do you strike a balance? Can you give us some take home pointers, Dr. Bhuvaneshwari?
Number one is healthy cooking. As you rightly said, this is not a holiday time to enjoy your food or alcohol. Many, if you see the supermarket, the first shelves which got emptied were the chips and chocolates and biscuits. Because people are at home. Quantity, that is portion control, is a must. I'm not telling nobody should take it, but don't binge eat because you're bored. There are enough things we can do, we can learn. We need to do physical activity, calorie burning physical activity. So my main take home message would be cut down, portion control is a must. Learn to eat healthy, learn to cook healthy. Do physical activity regularly. Do not think it's a holiday to enjoy a meal or sleep, oversleep. Sleep is important, but not doing any activity and sleeping will definitely make you gain weight. And we can trim down a little on carbohydrate, increase the protein, you might feel fuller quickly.
Definitely.
So, if you allow me, whatever madam said, added to that, if you have to put everything, each of your meal on a plate format, which NIN has actually propagated to everybody, it's very easy. Half your plate should be full with fruits and vegetables. It could be in the raw form, it could be half cooked, it could be steamed, it could be in any, but half your plate. Quarter your plate should be protein foods. It could be your dal and a combination of dal, curd and egg or non-vegetarian food. And quarter, that is 25% of your plate, can be carbohydrates, especially focusing on whole grains and whole pulses. So this would make it more easy to follow for all of us, where you get a balanced diet, but you get everything in a plate form.
Yeah, definitely. I agree with you. Since we're talking about plates, let us just talk about another different plate. Is that even if you serve a large quantity of food in a bigger plate, it looks small. Whereas if you serve a small quantity of food in a smaller plate, it still looks big. So definitely, yes, that is a little trick. You can trick your mind to kind of do that. So if we are coming to almost the tail end of our panel discussion, so one last question to Dr. Radha is that it's a burning question that most people will have, and we just briefly talked about with Dr. also. So what kind of physical activities that could be done at home? Let's say we don't have access to gym equipment, we don't have the treadmills at or all those things at home. What do you suggest in such a lockdown period? Various, some of them were already mentioned by Dr. Bhuvanaswamy, but can you add some more activities to this that would help the audience to burn the excess calories?
Yeah, this is a very nice aspect of weight reduction, because, or even weight maintenance, because even though you control your diet, doing a regular physical activity or moderate physical activity will be advantageous in maintaining your weight, or sometimes even weight reduction on a calorie restricted diet. And these exercises which you generally want to do at home because you don't have access to your gym or going out could be something as simple as doing yoga, which is of course not a weight reduction program, but at least tones your muscles and builds your expenditure spending capacity. And then you can do something like skipping at home, which is very easy. Or you do certain slow jogging in the house. You can't do that jog at one place. Or sometimes, for a few of them, for weight maintenance, you can always do with weights at home, lifting weights, small amounts, whatever dumbbells you have at home, you can always do or just do at home. And there are most of our houses where we do have an exercise cycle at home. Not necessarily that you should be going to a gym, but then doing on an exercise cycle or standalone doing exercises at home that will tone up your muscle. Or aerobics at home also would be really nice. You just have to put on the internet, search certain aerobic exercises online and then do the exercise, which would be really great to do at home during this time of lockdown.
Absolutely. So definitely there are a lot of activities you could do at home. It is called regular activities, like you're walking, you're stretching exercises or climbing up and down the stairs. Everything burns calories. If you're bored, go out there, do some gardening. And I play around with your kids or pets, walk your pet, do all those things. I think everything burns calories. And maybe you can help your family in the cleaning up of the house, washing the dishes, whatever else. I think question to Dr. Radha is that this is a question from Ms. Nina Luthra. What is the role of probiotics and prebiotics with respect to building immunity?
Yeah, the gut... as already told, is the largest immune organ in the body. Keeping a healthy gut would help in building up our immunity, and this can happen with good amount of prebiotics and probiotics. One common thing which is to a certain extent a myth or a false understanding, that curd is a probiotic. I hope the others will agree. But then yogurt is a probiotic, where you have some amount of microorganisms added to it and you know that it works in your body and it really helps in having a healthy gut. Whereas curd is always dependent on the starter that we add to, unless and until we are taking a real sour curd where it has fermented for a few more hours, and then to a certain extent it may help. But generally the probiotic curd is not considered, but yogurt, yes. Prebiotics, there are foods like onion, like garlic, which really help us in improving our act as prebiotics to the gut and help in. More than these two, prebiotics and probiotics, you can also think about whole pulses, where they contain large quantities of soluble fiber, and the soluble fiber helps in formation of short-chain fatty acids in the body. These also act as good building of the microbiome in the gut, and so they help in good gut health for the body. So it is not just about taking these prebiotics and probiotics singularly, but they should become a part of a whole balanced diet. No food is going to work as a miracle for building immunity or acting as an element on its own unless taken as part of a balanced diet.
And had wonderfully said, and adding to that is what I'll borrow some from Dr. Bhuvaneshwar, what she said. It is the balanced diet with ample amount of physical activity and a good lifestyle and appropriate sleep. I think those are also the factors that would boost the immunity, just not taking pre and probiotics. And one interesting fact I would like to share with the audience is that there is a thought process. Next question to Dr. Radha. Which oil from Swati Patel, which oil would you recommend in general for health? And is desi ghee a good source of fat? That can you take this question?
Yeah, there is no specific goodness that you would get from a single oil. Every oil is good, provided the quantity is what is to be maintained. It is 20 ml per person per day, which is recommended quantity. And you can keep changing the oil every month. You can change from sunflower, safflower, to rice bran oil, to olive oil, to canola oil. These things can keep changing. But the quantity, no matter what is the kind of oil that is taken, but the quantity control, portion control is what is essential for oil usage. Yes, according to traditional beliefs and our practices, ghee has been a part of our diet. I wouldn't say ghee is not at all good. I wouldn't say it is excellent, but you can use it now and then. But remember the point that whether you use oil, ghee, butter or anything, your total quantity of visible oil per day is 20 a day. So if you are using, then you have to reduce your oil. If you are using butter, then you have to reduce your oil. So this is what is important.
So why do you recommend rotating oils? Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah. That's because the composition, kinds of oil contain saturated fatty acids. Certain kinds of oils like rice bran oil and olive oil contain greater quantity of monounsaturated fatty acids. So it is these fatty acids which have to rotate, being, and each one of these have a role in our body, that you have to rotate these oils which have high amount of saturated fatty acids and low amount of monounsaturated fatty acids, or high amount of monounsaturated and low amount of polyunsaturated each time every month, so that you get a varied kind of fatty acids to the body.
Sure. I guess some essential fatty acids are present in one kind of oil and the other kind of oil has other kind of essential fatty acids. So rotating that makes probably a little bit more sense there also, right?
Yes.
And what about
fatty acids? Okay.
What about the ghee? What do you think about the ghee?
That's what I said. You cannot totally say don't take. You cannot totally say please take. It is a win-win situation or like a balance. For
sure.
Quantity of oil, because it contains a large quantity of saturated fatty acids and it may not be considered healthy when taken in large quantities. So you have to have portion control when you are using ghee.
So you basically, idea is not to just take only oils or only ghee, just have a combination of all of those. Yeah, and then the last but
yes.
One question.
Whether you are poor or rich. that would be my answer about developing immunity. With regard to nutrition,
right.
Choose the economic consensus.
What is more important in this section of population is safe drinking water.
Yes.
Because that is going to be the highest risk factor for gastrointestinal conditions, which would actually aggravate the problem of malnutrition among this population. So safe drinking water is most essential along with hygiene and whatever other points that madam has added to locally available seasonal fruits and vegetables to be consumed.
Sure. One thing associated with terrible malnutrition, I think in a way it could be a blessing in disguise to boost our immunity, because we are in an emerging nation where we are exposed to a lot of pathogens, the dirt, soil. We still enjoy walking bare feet on the ground, and we let our children play on the street. So these things, they tend to boost the immunity because you're exposed to these pathogens earlier on in your life. So the same thing does not apply to a Caucasian person who's grown up all his life in the city of Manhattan in a high-rise apartment, who when they come to India for the first time, they say, oh my God, there's a buffalo, right? So that is something we see every day. So this is the variation that we observe. I think with that kind of a thought process, I think we should close this session. I sincerely thank each and every one of the panelists. You have added so much to this discussion. I couldn't thank you enough. And thank you all for being here today.
Thank you. Pleasure.
Yes. That should bring us to the end of this panel discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.